No, look, Anthony.
Brother Billy, can you hold this for... Okay. I just gotta take... Me up quick here. You know, thank you so much. Okay. I got it. Okay. Now, you know, okay, hold on a second. I'm looking for something. I gotta, you know, it's not there. It's money in that pocket. Oh. Or it's change, but it's money anyway. Currency, as they say. I'm looking for my, you know, my little book I've always carried with the little pen in it. I got so many pockets over my thing. See, because I'm talking about a thing that happens every year about this time, but I wrote some notes down. Man.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. What's there in your chest pocket?
Oh, ew. The ravages of old age.
Oh,
you don't forget where you put it. And I got too many pockets. Now, as I was saying, this is the time of year when you have, you know, your agencies or whatever, your people, what they do is they come in the end of the year and they realize, hey, I got some money. We better spend this so we can, you know, have money for next year. Because if we don't spend it, they're going to say, hey, you didn't spend it, you'll need less money next year. You know how that goes. So they get these things here. Now, I was at one yesterday, you know, with my other group there. And it was, I won't say what the department is, but I looked at they got these boards over there. They had the vision and the mission and all the rest of that stuff and those kind of things. Now, here's the vision of this particular agency that serves the people in South Africa, Eastern Cape. I guess it's all over too. Vision, a caring society for the protection and development of the poor and vulnerable towards a sustainable society. Now, since I was in the NGO world, I can decipher all that. They use these kind of words. But let me say, a caring society. What does that mean? Well, you know, caring society. For the protection and development. Okay, so this agency is charged with protecting and developing of the poor and vulnerable towards a sustainable society. In other words, if you don't get the poor and vulnerable on board, then your society is going to collapse. I mean, I think that's what it says. And their mission is to transform society, and they go on with that kind of thing. But here's what I want to say about that. Here's the problem. They always have, they say the poor and the vulnerable. Well, the poor and the vulnerable are not in the agencies that's trying to protect and, you know, the poor and the vulnerable. So you always have somebody outside of the thing telling you what to do. They don't live in the community. Even if they lived in the community, they live well in the community. The poor and vulnerable, they step over the poor and vulnerable to get to the church and stuff like that. You know how that works. So this concerns me because I don't want to say it's a scam, but people think it's a scam. The kids I was with, they go like, we don't want it. And the other people come in for the food. Because most of the budget is not spent, most of the budget is spent on food, transport food. So there's the problem. We don't have the poor and the vulnerable doing stuff to raise themselves up. We have some other people, and this is historic. I mean, this is historic because every place in the world, you have everybody keep on speaking for the poor and the vulnerable. Meanwhile, they're ripping the poor and vulnerable off.
Yeah.
Now, I don't want to go too far off topic, but there's this guy, I read this guy, Chris Hedges from the States. You know, he's an upright guy, you know, the war correspondent. He did a lot of kind of stuff. But he just got ordained. He's supposed to have been ordained like years ago, 25 years ago, but he's one of those radical guys, and they wouldn't allow him to be ordained. So he just got ordained. At his ordination in New Jersey, a small church in New Jersey, he had, you know, several other preachers, you know, theologians, you know, speaking on his behalf. And this one guy, I think his name is Cole, there's this brother. He wrote this thing on black liberation theology back there in the 60s. And the reason why he wrote it is because he both respected Martin Luther King you know, Christian, and Malcolm X, you know, from the Nation of Islam. He respected both of them. But he looked, and looking at it, because he's a theologian, he's one of those people that think, he was thinking like, okay, I see what's going on. Martin Luther King is more informed by his Christianity. See, he knows he's black and black and secular, but he's more of his Christianity. Malcolm X is informed by his blackness or his Africanness. Now what happened, but he was trying to figure, this guy was trying to figure out, how can I get them both together? And what he figured out is that as a Christian, when he's reading, you know, the text, the Bible, he realized, oh, well, Christian meaning you follow Christ, you know, the Christ, when he was hanging out, he was hanging with the poor. And I guess Christianity didn't exist yet because he wasn't ascending or dead or whatever they do for, to make the Christians. And Malcolm, though, again, he is black, he was identifying again with the poor. So the thing is with the poor. So what I'm trying to say is that everybody speaks for the poor, but few live like them and want to do, few really do that poor people's march, you know, getting people out of jail, blah, 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 blah. They don't do that. They don't create, they're in a system that they don't make the system work for the poor. They help the system continue to rip the poor off in the name of the poor. How do you rip the poor off in the name of the poor? But that's what the game is.
Mm.
It's upsetting. It's upsetting.
Mm.
And I don't want to be upset. So I'm just going to leave it there. This has been one of those dispatches from the Arts Director Emeritus. That would be me, T, from the Pattersons, taking the trench to Tibet, letting you know what I only suspect.